Okay, that pitch right there was short, hard-hitting, and I think a great way to set the stage for what's going to happen now. Now we're going to have a panel, Increasing the Rate of Innovation. Moderating the panel is David Fastabend of, interestingly enough, Fastabend Solutions, LLC. So I'm going to turn it over to Dave.
Thank you, Chief.
Yeah, who hardly needs an introduction to this crowd.
Well, as the Chief pointed out, we could hardly have had a better condition setter than Lieutenant General McMaster and his presentation he just gave about the role of innovation with respect to the AOC. I have never seen, in my long history of observing the Army and how it thinks, a more overt focus on this topic. Within the AOC, innovation is a tenet, and it says that innovation is absolutely deemed critical for leaders and soldiers and the teams they lead to succeed, to win in a complex world. And it's consistently apparent in all the Army messaging. And some of the panel members here today, in fact, have participated in what is in effect a persistent and protracted campaign of events focused on the topic of innovation. Some of them were at an event at the College of William and Mary in mid-January, focused on this topic. So the outcomes we have for this panel, what we hope is that at the end of this panel, you're going to understand how the Army innovates. You're going to be able to identify what the Army, together with external agencies, must do to accelerate the rate of innovation. And you're going to understand the Army's role in many of the innovation initiatives that are apparent today. To help you get to that point, I'd encourage you, as you listen to this excellent panel, to think about five key questions. What are the current obstacles to innovation today? What is the Army or the DoD or the government doing right or wrong with respect to innovation? No kidding, for real, how does the Army and industry innovate? What are the planned and pending initiatives to increase the rate of innovation? And getting back to the AOC, which is the big integrating document of our Army today, what are the most pressing problems implicit in the AOC that innovation should address? So just as it is a complex world, we have a wonderfully diverse panel that addresses this topic. We're going to start out with Major General Cedric Wins. He is running the Capabilities Development Directorate in RCIC. This is one of the front lines and cutting edges of change. If you ascribe to the theory that no matter how forward-looking and advanced we are, someone has to make the donuts, I think General Wins' organization makes the donuts of change, because they have to deal with it every day, and I think he'll have some interesting insights for us. We've got Robert Coker. Robert is the president and CEO of Ideal Innovations Incorporated. He is a former PM from DARPA. He's also the founder of the Army's Quick Response Office and led a lot of our most key efforts to adapt during OIF and OEF. Innovation has been Robert's business for the last 17 years at least. In addition, he's thought deeply about the topic of innovation. You should feel yourself cheated if you leave this event without understanding his theory of the key elements that lead to innovation, because I think it's one of the most important elements of thinking on this topic. Dr. Thomas Russell is director of the Army Research Lab, so we've got a key voice of the institutional Army. He's had that institutional role to ID and accelerate technologies that enable innovation. We also have Dr. Christopher Fall. Now, you can see in a minute, I'll get to General Perkins, and you think, well, General Perkins is the big picture guy. But you could argue that Dr. Fall might have a simply bigger picture. He works as the Assistant Director for Defense Programs in the Office of Science and Technical Policy in the Executive Office of the President. So that is the big picture, and we're interested in his perspective on innovation. And then finally, his earlier comments about being put at the end of panels because he was considered expendable inspired me to place General Perkins at the end of this panel, not because he's expendable, but because you save your best hitter for the last inning, and he's also there to correct any doctrinal and theological errors. So please join me in welcoming this panel, and then we'll have General Wins come to the podium.
Good afternoon. As General Fastaben indicated, I've been the front line of a number of requirements here that have come through TRADOC over the last 2 years, covering the full range of the initial capabilities development documents, the capabilities development documents, and the production documents. And so one of the things that I would like to speak to is what I have experienced and what I've seen in terms of requirements over the last 20 months. And I say this because I think that over the last 20 months, I've gotten some insight into what we do with requirements and how we do things right and how we do some things that probably could be better improved. And obviously, the panel is about increasing the rate of innovation, because I would argue that given the Army that we've had and the successes that we've had, we've always been a fairly innovative Army. So the real question is, how do we improve or increase the rate of innovation in order to regain the overmatch in some of the formations that have been lost, and how do we see ourselves going forward to take advantage of opportunities that might be out there as a result of technology to better enhance the capabilities of the future force? And so first thing I'd like to do is just kind of highlight a couple of things in terms of examples, three examples that I asked my staff to go back and take a look at and just kind of give me a little insight on some things. And there are really three capabilities that the Army saw itself going after, going back as far as 1999. I didn't want to go back too far. So the first one was the Striker effort. And interestingly enough, the Army, if you use Striker as an example, was able to rapidly define the requirement for Striker and rapidly fill that capability. And so the requirements document started off with its approval about in 1999, and by 2003, we were at FOC, where we were deploying a Striker brigade into Iraq. And I'll talk in a minute about what contributed to the success of that, and certainly the rapid fielding of that. Certainly everything was not perfect in that effort, but there were some things that you could point to when we start talking about acquiring things rapidly. The second would be the route clearance capability that we found ourselves in need of during both OIF and OEF, which resulted in the development and production of capabilities such as the Husky and the Buffalo. And those came by way of an ONS, as many of you probably are aware, which is an operational need statement coming from the combatant commands in the field. So the field asked for that capability because they saw an immediate need for it. And then one that's currently going, we're undergoing right now, which is JLTV. And there was a previous question directed at General McMaster's about whether or not we do things jointly. And so JLTV certainly is an example of a joint venture that we've worked and partnered with the Marine Corps. JLTV also might be an example of a capability that we're going after through the deliberate process of the JSIDS process. So it has not been rapid, but I think on the back end of it, it'll reflect that it was a well-defined and well-managed effort in that we think we're getting the capability that we need. So of these three, what are some of the good things that you can point to that occurred in each of these? I think one of the key points that I learned, particularly with the Striker and our effort to get that, was that you had focused and consistent and persistent leadership oversight on getting that capability. So Stryker started off with the Chief of Staff determining, along with others, that there was a gap in our medium weight capability and just going after it. And the persistence of leadership focus played a large part in us getting that capability. The second thing I think you could point to as something good in that was the requirements were clearly defined and developed within the constraints of time, technology, and the resources that were available and the resources that you could put towards getting those capabilities. And defining that in terms of what was essential and what would be enhancing to that capability. In other words, defining the trade space by which you could work to define and acquire that capability. I think another point that I would make as people start talking about different ways to work the process is having an understanding of the process. So oftentimes we have people who want to short circuit the process as opposed to shortcut the process. And so I go to just as an example, Bill Belichick is probably recognized as one of the most innovative football coaches in the NFL. And he's innovative not because he lacks the understanding of the process, but more importantly, he understands the gray areas within which he can operate within the process. So in the instances that I've seen over my last 20 months, we have had difficulty when we try to short-circuit the process, but we have been successful when we have the right type of leadership focus, and in those instances where we can work to shortcut the process. But the important point is you got to have a pretty good understanding of how the process works. Now, as it pertains to our efforts to get to it, advanced capabilities or accelerating capabilities, I think that going back a little bit in time and understanding how certain efforts took place with Force 2020, Force 21, we understand that there are other ways to ensure that the process can be accelerated. And so I think things with the Force 21 maneuvers, the Army warfighting experiments, will allow us to rapidly speed capability to the force. Now, that brings us to some areas where we can improve, and I think a lot of them have been hit this morning and early this afternoon. And so the collaboration that occurs can always be better, and so we just need to get to that. I think we need to recognize where industry is and when they're out in front of us, the Army, in terms of the capabilities that they have already advanced technologically, that we don't need to try to repeat those efforts. We have to be able to understand how to try things, how to fail, how to try new things, and then to adopt what works. And we have to be able to accept that as the Army and as we define our requirements, that we're never going to be the experts at designing and building and fielding the perfect solution. And it's through iterations that we've gotten capabilities that we have, such as the Bradley, such as the Abrams tank. And I think that over time we can deliver a better capability that with each iteration it gets improved over time. So with that, I'll stop.
I've served 6 years at DARPA doing their quick response projects for Somalia, Haiti, Bosnia, Croatia, Macedonia, helicopter shootdown in Korea, and some other activities. And then after Somalia, the deputy AMC commander said, hey, we need to set up an Army office. And I was asked to set up the Army quick response office, which was set up after Somalia, and it went through four directors. What I'm going to talk about is how to accelerate innovation, but this is material, normally material, and on the real urgent edge. There's two components of this. One, you have to have the right environment to accelerate innovation or to do innovation, and I'll talk about the three components of that. And the second, you have to get ahead of the incident. That will really help you out. In the old days, the Cold War days, the Soviets would come out with the FST-3 tank in 5 years, and we would work for 5 years on a gun that would defeat the tank. So when it came out in 5 years or whatever, that we would match that. In this environment, it's hard to say what's going to be needed in the next 12 months. It's hard to say what's going to be needed in the next several years. It seems to be a little bit easier to say what we'll need in the future because we have more time for that. But to get ahead of the power curve, you really have to look at getting left of an incident. There's a lot of scrambling once there's an incident. So here, the idea of having people that can anticipate, normally from the sinks, combatant commands, what are your key what are your key issues in the next 12 months? What do you think is going to happen? And we did a program along that line. The environment, you need to have three key people or three key organizations. One is a senior visionary. This is the person that controls resources, that sets priority. It could be in different organizations. This is the Warren Buffett of how to spend our resources. Somebody needs to say, this will probably work, but it doesn't have priority over this or that. And it has to be at a very high level. Second, you need an informed inventor. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. But an inventor, somebody comes up with ideas, they need to really understand the environment. And there are a lot of different inventors, but they need to know where to go to bring stuff up. Third, you need the technology SMEs or the acquisition SMEs. You need the ARLs, BRLs, ARDEX, the people that really understand the technology can look and say, what this inventor has is not going to work. Or you have the program managers that can say, look, what this inventor has, it will work, but here's the problems. And to implement it, you have to go ahead and do that. So an example of an informed inventor. Okay, in Somalia, going through Mogadishu, get shot at, hammered all the time. And the incident was the squad leaders would say, look, we don't even know when we're being shot at. Something hits the windshield. Now, these were unarmored Humvees, just straight Humvees with cloth panels or whatever. So at DARPA did a project to quickly armor 50 and because they had deep pockets and they could do it quick. That's kind of how that went. But we needed to know sniper detection. So DARPA got involved. The undersea, the Naval Systems Office that did submarine acoustic detection, basically had technologies. So we had to simulate the environment in the United States. We got with BRL or ARL. They set up a range at Aberdeen where we put seven companies, personnel, and sensors downrange, and then we take shots over their head. It was before your time, but and anybody that's been downrange for a shot going by, if it passes to your right, that's exactly where you think it came from. And sensors were developed there, but we knew that was going to take time. It was going to take years to solve acoustically how shots were done. But the quick solution in Mogadishu, somebody came up with an idea, look, let's build a road that goes around Mogadishu down to the port so we don't have to go through Mogadishu that much. The technology, you know, again, the labs, they can see new technologies coming out. That kind of goes to the senior visionary. Here's some new technologies emerging. Here's some new things that are emerging. You know, but the visionary has to decide when, where, how much resources to put against it. There was, again, for the informed inventor, another incident for detecting mines. It couldn't be simulated at Belvoir, so we took the people from Night Vision Lab over to Somalia real quick and went into the new road that was built. Putting in real mines so we could detect them with IR. It was all good until a cobra came by and circled three times, but finally called and said, yes, those are the DARPA guys putting in mines in the road. But that looked, again, informed in the environment, the actual environment, what happens. And again, we relied on the labs to simulate threats, to simulate the exact threat environments along that line. So the senior visionary, again, the Warren Buffett, looks to the future, the 2025, the things that are coming in there. The intel kind of will give you a little estimate of what's happening a little bit closer in. But it's the SYNCs and the COCOMs that say, this is what I need now, and to kind of look at that and allocate along that line. When we set up the quick response office, the movie Ghostbusters came out, and there was the phrase, who are you going to call? And we had a phrase there to say, look, if you have a problem or a solution, who are you going to call? And that was at AMC. Small office, 10 people, that would farm it out to other people along that line. One of the problems today, when you do have a problem, you know, who are you going to call? Somebody commented there's different organizations, different rice bowls, and kind of centralizing that would be very helpful from an industry perspective. I think the senior visionaries is more of TRADOC, Arctic, AWG environment. What should happen? What's really going on? And I think the material solutions, AMC has their own contracting command, their own links to testing, labs, logistics, transportation, everything. They got the ability to deliver and execute. So to accelerate innovation, it's you got to have the right environment that you can bring an idea to and that people can evaluate it quickly, scientifically and need-wise, and you need to get ahead. What is the right problem? What are the things that we're trying to solve? Thank you.
Pleasure to be here. I was trying to figure out what I would say for 5 minutes that might be enough to induce questions where people would be interested in the innovation topic. So I'm probably going to go a little bit off course just in the sequence of what we've done. So the first thing I want to do is I want to start off by saying that, you know, we as a group have been innovative for the last several decades. General Wins mentioned this in his opening comments. And the problem here really is about rate, right? It's not about the fact that we're not innovative, we're not creative, that we don't discover new things, that we don't know how to do development, we don't know how to transition. We actually do that on a regular basis. Over the last decade plus, we've been moving technology to the field in a very rapid timeline to save soldiers' lives and protect soldiers on a regular basis as well. The real problem here, I think, is it's the pain of exponentials, right? So, and what do I mean by the pain of exponentials? So the pain of exponentials, if you think about Moore's law, is that we actually increase computing power every 18 months by a factor of two. So let me give you an example that would be on sort of the other side of that. So if I have an analyst who we need to actually analyze information on, we often talk about what are the tools I can provide an analyst to be more effective at his job. And often when we have that conversation, we talk about I might be able to improve that analyst by a factor of two or maybe a factor of three. And that might take me 2 or 3 years to accomplish that. But the information space and the amount of information which is growing globally actually grows at a factor of 10. So this is your pain of exponentials. Because what we've now done over the same period of time is we've given a tool to an analyst to do twice as much work or three times as much work, but they're still an order of magnitude behind the amount of information they need to analyze. So how do we actually address this problem? And I think that's really what I think this panel's about is how do we really begin to think about this pain of exponentials and how do we begin to think about ways to create that rate or innovate it away fast enough so we can actually change the exponential to our favor as opposed to our adversary's favor? And I would indicate that I think it was well articulated by General McMaster, General Perkins earlier today, the engagement with the warfighter and getting that feedback loop, but there's another feedback loop we lost over the last couple of decades, and that is that we've set up the system through the foundations by Vannevar Bush in his papers to the president post-World War II. Now, we've discounted many of that because he believed that there was this linear process of 6-1, 6-2, 6-3, and really that's an iterative process. But part of the heart of that paper was what we really needed was synergy between industry, academia, and the government system. And it was that synergy which would actually ensure that we would no longer have technological surprise because we would work as an ecosystem. We would work together to solve the problems. The conversations, and I'll be very frank, would not be about money. They would be about solutions. And we need to figure out how to recreate that ecosystem. How do we bring these entities together and the fourth entity, the warfighter, together So we create the ecosystem where we actually rapidly develop and work together to actually think, focus on the outcomes and what we can produce for the warfighter. And so what we have done is we've actually put you at arm's length. So since the 1950s, industry and academia have evolved tremendously. We as a government laboratory system actually have become what I would define as being much more insular, especially post 9/11. Now, so what that means is that we're not really working together. And what does that ecosystem really mean to the advancement of technology? So if we're in early developmental stages, wouldn't it be great to be working side by side with industry partners so you can give guidance on how you might actually manipulate or change the way we're discovering things, or look in new areas so that we might actually help understand how to develop that as products? Same thing with the warfighter and how the warfighter might actually utilize those tools and give us feedback early in the process as we develop technologies and begin to think about how we transition those. That's what I think is really missing. It's really about how do we change that pain of exponentials? How do we get back to the point where we work together as a community in sync as an ecosystem, where our employees actually have the opportunity to freely move amongst our institutions, so that my staff members may work in your organizations all year long, or 15% of my staff might be working in your organizations at any given time, and 15% of your staffs might be working in my organization at any given time, so that we start to cross-fertilize and begin to actually have the opportunity to work and create this ecosystem of facilities, people, infrastructure, and how we actually move science and technology forward. So I would propose that this is really the way we begin to address the rate of innovation. We all know how to innovate. We just need to start getting beyond the rice bowls and how we actually begin to innovate together. And I think you've heard so far today, it's really about the outcomes. What are the outcomes and capabilities that we want to accomplish? But it's really about what are the outcomes and capabilities that we want to accomplish as a community, not as individual organizations, but as a community. How do we work together to give that technology the best opportunity? So I will tell you, in the Army, we are trying to do this. We have created a business model to try and look at, can you create more of an open environment between the laboratories and our partners where we can have this ecosystem? And I would suggest that maybe we need to think about that as we move forward. Is there a way we could work more effectively together as we develop technologies and as we innovate so that we can get ahead of this exponential curve? Because right now our challenge is that we're behind on the exponential curve. Our exponentials are at a different rate than our adversaries. And unless we change that, no matter how much we innovate, we'll never keep pace. Thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Chris Fall, and I'm the Assistant Director for Defense Programs at the Office and of Science and Technology Policy, and I have the privilege of supporting Dr. John Holdren, who's the Science Advisor to the President, and I just want to thank you all for including us in this conversation. I think this is going to be a really interesting panel. So our charge is to put some ideas out there, stimulate the conversation about the rate of innovation and reference the Army operating concept. I just want to give you a little bit of background, though. The Office of Science, you may not understand what the Office of Science and Technology Policy does. I would say remarkably few people outside the science, technology, and innovation ecosystem even know that we exist. We're comprised of four divisions. We have a science division, we have an environment and energy division, we have a technology and innovation division, and we have the National Security and International Affairs Division that I'm a part of. And we also have new for this administration the Office of the Chief Technology Officer. That's Megan Smith, and she's just started recently. So traditionally, what OSTP has done is to provide the policy for science, right, the sort of big picture issues particularly relevant to interagency coordination and integration, and then the science for policy, and that's really the support role for the President. If he's going to deal with things that involve science and technology, he needs to have the right answers, and that's kind of our job. But new for this administration is this whole of government push for innovation, and it really does involve the technology and innovation team and the Office of the Chief Technology Officer. And So, and across, you know, in the rest of the rest of the country, in the private sector. And so, you know, if you didn't know that, this push for innovation is a new thing, and that's what we do spend an awful lot of time on. And it, you know, what I'm trying to communicate is that the Army's push for innovation sits within a context of a much broader effort across all the agencies of the federal government. So again, I want to just cue up four quick things, just some thoughts to get the to stimulate the conversation. First of all, I am a scientist, and my perspective is science and technology. But I'd like to reinforce what an organization steeped in concepts like maneuver, like the Army, already understands, and that is that the real opportunities in innovation aren't just about technology, right? It's about business process, it's about people process, it's about ConOps, and that's something I know you understand because it's really well reflected in the new AOC. That's one of the best documents I've seen. That takes innovation and brings it outside of the technical realm and talks about the wider context. So that's number one. Along those lines, I think that if we're talking about the rate of innovation, we need to understand and leverage our core cultural strengths. And what do I mean by that? You know, it's natural to want to be Google, to embrace the culture of Silicon Valley, to be one of the cool kids, if you will. But Silicon Valley, while it is an amazing machine for innovation and economic development, really is on the far end of the spectrum for risk tolerance, you know, ambiguity, et cetera. We're talking in the VC community, 90% failure is a completely reasonable number. And, you know, I don't know that that's completely congruent with an organization that has a day job to protect the nation, right? And so it's okay to want or to be comfortable wearing a tie to work. I wore my blue and gold Army tie for the occasion. Okay, come on. Sorry, I'm on detail from the Department of the Navy, so. It's okay to be comfortable wearing a tie to work. It's okay to embrace order and have, you know, want to have a predictable career and so forth. And there are great examples of remarkable organizations with very hierarchical structures that have built innovation in very effectively. The Procter and Gambles of the world, the IBMs of the world, many of our defense industrial partners are, you know, relatively conservative organizations, and yet they're able to adapt and build innovation in. It's hard, and it's hard because it's about process and not about individuals. But I think that's something that sort of resonates with the Army. So, you know, who are we, or what is the Army, what is our culture, and how do we leverage that to be most effective in innovation? Because if you're getting anything out of the innovation discussions at this meeting, there are a lot of different models for innovation. So that's number two. Number three, I do want to say, I want to turn to technology, and again, kudos to the folks who developed the AOC, because it's a very effectively integrates a technology. There is the whole Appendix C, I think it was. You know, we do have a particular technical challenge that I think we all need to be aware of, and I'll say it, I don't know that it's come up explicitly, maybe Tom sort of touched on it, and that is that for 50 years after the Second World War, we owned the technical edge, right? We owned the basic research edge, we owned the technical edge, and our science, technology, and innovation enterprise, the constellation of contractors, labs, et cetera, that comprise that, are really built on the premise that we own the technical edge. We don't have that anymore. It's really been inverted. And so when we talk about the pace of innovation, you know, the leading technology is in the private sector. It really doesn't reside all the time within the government laboratories and diffuse out. We need to figure out how to make it diffuse in faster. So that's a fundamental limitation on our rate of innovation, is figuring out, we haven't done that very well, figure out how to get the technology flowing into the system. There are all sorts of roadblocks. And finally, I would offer just a little constructive criticism about DOD in general. And from our seat at OSTP, we do get to look across the government. We do spend a lot of time working with congressional staff or through, to contribute to legislation or help shape legislation to work on executive actions that will cut through some of the barriers to innovation, provide tools for innovation, just make things easier for everyone. And I would say that DOD is not out in front in leveraging the latitude that agencies of the federal government already have. So I'll just say that again. There are a lot of possibilities, and it's particularly when it comes to things like contracting, other transaction authority, use of innovation mechanisms like open innovation prizes and challenges, and in particular, personnel policies applied to the technical workforce. We're not using the latitude that we already have. And, the Army is an organization that takes kids in, gives them, teaches them the rules, teaches them initiative, and then pushes responsibility and decision-making down to the lowest level possible to be effective. We should do that for the civilian side as well and for the technical workforce. I don't think that's too much to ask, and I think it would make us all more effective. So I'll stop there. I think I'm a little over time.
General Fassbender was very kind, saying that he had saved the best for last. Actually, what he told me in the green room is, hey, Dave, I think you need a little bit more time than the others to collect your thoughts to give a coherent discussion, so I'm going to put you in. That gives you another 20 minutes to figure out what you're going to say, but at least he packaged it well when we came out here. But then he also said, hey, we'll put the trade-out guy at the end and kind of put everything, make sure we're doctrinally correct, and so I'll live up to that end of the bargain. And so as I talked about, when I talked about the AOC, what I spent a lot of time on is making sure we design a strategy to achieve an end state versus coming up with a plan to spend money. And so when we take a look at rate of innovation, we have put together a strategy to deliver an end state as defined by increasing the rate of innovation to produce valued outcomes to let us seize, retain, exploit the initiative to get to a position of relative advantage. Valued outcomes, as HR was saying, not just random good ideas, valued outcomes that puts us in a position of relative advantage. And then, of course, as I went over the chart earlier, which is see how all these things relate together, you then have the ways and means. And so when you take a look at a way to achieve that end of the strategy, and I've spent a lot of time with folks who are much more of an expert than I am in innovation, there's generally four major ways that a lot of people that are involved in innovation approach when they look at their organization, and that is, fool around the structure to improve innovation, come up with motivators, bonuses to people or whatever if they motivate, adjust decision rights, and increase information flow. Now, the first one that a lot of people choose, and if you come from a hierarchical organization like the Army is, whatever it is, whenever you get a new mission, the first thing you do is retask organize. So a lot of times the desire is to change the structural flow, line of block diagram, who works for who, et cetera, like that. And that's almost the first inclination. Of the four, that is absolutely historically proven to be the worst way to increase innovation is to, first of all, fool around the structure of your organization. Generally, the next thing people come up with is now that we've changed all the structure, we've got to motivate people to innovate, so we'll have bonuses or you get a parking spot right in front of the commissary or something like that if you come up with a good idea. Of course, unfortunately, historically, that's the second worst way to increase rate of innovation in an organization. It's just through pure motivational things like that. The number one way at a rate of 2 to 3 times greater than the first two that I talked about to increase rate of innovation is increase information flow. And so we decided let's spend our time on things historically that have proven to be useful. And then the second thing that is, again, twice as useful as the other two that aren't is decision rights, getting the decision rights properly aligned. So going back to the first way on increasing information flow, if you are going to do that, then what does that mean? And then what are the means to accomplish that way? So one of them is we have increased, and we've talked about it a lot already, collaboration between folks within the Army. So you saw in the first panel that we had the G8 of the Army here, we had the Arctic Director. We had a lot of people that need to be part of this collaboration process. And as we talked before, we used to look at things, and we still do to some extent, in warfighting functions, we disaggregated artificially what should have been a collaborative approach, because we would disaggregate into a warfighting function and then buy a thing to do that warfighting function, yet not get a capability to increase rate of innovation. So we are now collaborating in a much greater degree between the warfighting functions. The other thing that historically increases rate of innovation is increased rate of collaboration between the end item user and that who establishes the requirements, in this case, TRADOC, or produces it, or, you know, our folks, the resources and Army staff and ASALT that go out and get it. So what we've done with the warfighting challenges is say, hey, let's bring in the end item user to the people that come up with the requirements, TRADOC, and increase that rate of collaboration and have the DA staff in there. So we recently had a warfighting challenge at TRADOC headquarters down in our conference room, and it was on forced entry. So the person that we brought in to lead the discussion was the commanding general of the 82nd Airborne Division and the deputy commander of the 18th Airborne Corps. We actually checked our records, and we believe that is the first time the commanding general of the 82nd Airborne Division has actually ever been in TRADOC headquarters. So we had to give him a strip map and all that. And then on VTC, we had Major General Tom Vandal, the commanding general of the 2nd Infantry Division in Korea. Thankfully, due to his, his desire to be a team member, I think it was 3 o'clock in the morning there, and he was talking about weapons of mass destruction, subterranean operations, of which he has some very, high fidelity on what the requirements are. So we had him briefing the TRADOC staff of, let me tell you what the requirements are. So we are working to increase the information flow both within the people that generate requirements and resourcing, as well as the end item user, division commanders, corps commanders, et cetera, on what their real requirements are. The second most effective way of approaching this is dealing with, as I said, decision rights. So, and actually, Dr. Fall brought up a great point. When we talk to folks in the Army, hey, we have to get better at that. First thing is, well, you know, it's Congress's fault. They got to change the laws. We got to do this. And until we solve world hunger, we can't improve innovation. So you know what? I bet there's a lot of things within TRADOC that I have the authority to decide right now that could make things better. And then getting with the chief and the secretary, we said, you know, there's a lot of things actually within the Army that we have the authority right now. We can increase rate of collaboration, and it does not require an amendment to the NDAA. We can bring in people. And so what we've done is take a look at what can we do within TRADOC? What can we do within DA? What can we do within OSD to put the decision rights where they have to be? And then what are the key decisions at each one of those levels that are worth spending time on? In fact, General Sullivan and I were just talking right before we came up here that when you look at some of these things, there's really, you can boil it down to 3 or 4 big decisions. And once you make those, it's going to put in motion all kinds of activity. If you can get the senior leaders involved in that in the right forum and make those and then share that information flow throughout the organization, we think we can have a pretty good chance of increasing the rate of innovation. So that's our strategy. Those are our ways. And what are the means of increasing rate of information flow is bringing together industry, the Army, and others in forums like this so that you understand our strategy. So I'll stop there, and I guess we can go to questions then.
Wins, if you're okay with it, I'll start out with you.
Okay.
Here's the question. The Rapid Equipping Force is being moved under TRADOC, so will their mission serve to speed up full requirements development, i.e., is there a transition path between immediate needs and fully sustainable solutions? How do you see the REF working under TRADOC?
Well, I can speak to my thoughts about how REF could work under TRADOC, and then I'll let the commanding general talk about how the REF will operate under his command. But just to stay safe.
That's why you have such high potential, Cedric, for further advancement in the Army.
In talking to the folks at the REF, one of the unique aspects that I learned that they possess is, number one, they have the ability to take from the field the understanding of what the field requires to address that immediate need. So they have the ability to, number one, determine the requirement as it comes from the field. The second thing they have is the ability to go out to industry and with a defined requirement, with some left and right latitude, be able to find out what best fits or what meets that need. And then the third piece is they have the ability to rapidly acquire it. So they've kind of got the requirements piece. They've got the understanding of what material solution could, should, or might work, and they've got the ability to go out and rapidly acquire it. And I think the thing that they lack is the plug of how you sustain that capability. So, but that is not the point of urgency when they are going out to fulfill a capability. How you transition that, I think there's a very, very natural synergy that exists between what the REF can do and some of the other features of the Force 2025 effort. So, for example, if capabilities are coming out of the field that have demonstrated an enduring capability for the Army, I think there's a good opportunity for the Army to say, hey, we've already demonstrated this in the field. We know that it's a capability that either represents something that's game-changing or could be an enduring capability within the Army. And is there a need to go and apply that in a Army warfighting experiment to further demonstrate it where maybe it was very, very unique at the time, but we see a broader application? And so there's kind of a synergy that exists right there between what the REF can bring in and what potentially could go to an Army warfighting experiment. The next piece is what has been called the agile process, which was used associated with some of the capabilities that were coming out, and how you get things into that agile process could benefit the Army by producing capability a lot faster than the more deliberate process that we use. So I think there's a very, very natural synergy that you could use between linking the activities of the REF, linking the activities of the Army warfighting experiments, and then being able to front load those in or push those in very quickly in collaboration and conjunction with the rest of the players, the resource providers, the material development community, to bring any capabilities that the REF identifies in a lot faster. So I see it as a natural synergy.
Thank you. Yeah, just build upon that. You know, the chief is really focusing in on increasing the rate of innovation, and so he is making some decisions to align some capabilities. So not only has the REF moved to TRADOC, but so has AWG, Asymmetric Warfare Group. So now we actually get the synergy of both of those in there. Now it's interesting. And I'll talk about how we're going to actually use both of those together. It is a little bit of a combination, first of all, that the Army has an organization called the REF, because that must mean that if you had to stand up in an organization and do that, then the rest of the Army must be the NREF, the non-rapid equipping force, or else we wouldn't have had to stand that up. And so we are trying to actually, our goal is to make the whole Army a rapid equipping force. So that's the N. Now, what the REF does uniquely is, I told you the two most important things are information flow and decision rights. They combine those into one organization, and they have a lot of folks that are out and about with the combatant commanders, with the boots on the ground, getting an idea of what the requirements are. And then within their authority, then they can approve those requirements and actually, as Cedric then said, work through the acquisition process. So almost from beginning to end, you have one organization this kind of riding herd over it to make it rapid. Actually, another part that kind of escapes some people, and they almost see it as a downside, a lot of people say, well, how many of the solutions they came up with became a program or record, as if that's a positive metric? I think one of the things to innovation, if you study it, is not only what do you innovate quickly, but then also how quickly can you stop doing things that are no longer value added? And one of the problems is in our paradigms of acquisition, once something becomes a program or record, and even if you don't need it anymore, it is very difficult to stop that and move on to the next best thing. So in other words, if you're building the iPhone 3, you say, really, I need to go to an iPhone 4. Yeah, but you can't cancel this iPhone 3 thing because this is a 20-year program. Well, the good thing about the MRAF, they can start things quickly and they can stop things quickly. So when people say not that many of things have become program of record, I say thank you very much, because that gives us this ability to innovate quicker, to move on to the next best thing there. And so what we also are doing is taking the REF and partnering with the asymmetric warfare group that gets out, again, with the combatant commanders. They're with organizations that are dealing with subterranean. They're dealing with urban environment kind of problem sets. And they are coming up with some quick, immediate fixes to it. Some of them are doctrinal tactics, techniques, and procedures, but some are materiel. But then they can then pass them off to the REF to have a little bit of a longer-term solution. And then the REF can take a look and say, you know, there are some principles here. This was kind of a quick solution to get it to the soldier at the tip of the spear. But there's an organizing principle here that we think has some long-term applicability when you look at your next fighting vehicle, when you look at your next aviation asset. And so you can take those universal principles that you want to move to the next thing, but not get bogged down with the program of record. So it really is almost tailored-made to inform the Army on a good way to increase rate of innovation.
Thank you, General Perkins. And lest you get a break, there are three questions from the online audience that I'm going to compress together here, because I think you'd be perfect to answer them. Question number one, what kind of changes are necessary in the Army's educational institutions to prepare future Army leaders to innovate? Question number two, how are you harnessing the ideas of the next generation of leaders? Question number three, education and training is the heart of any military force. How are you preparing our soldiers, especially the enlisted soldiers, to think abstractly and broadly?
All right, sir. Yeah, great question. They are very much related. So I spent all day yesterday out at Fort Leavenworth, which is why I'm making sure I talk doctrinally correct today, and spent all day out there. One of the sessions I had was a multi-hour session with one of the chiefs. He has a solarium and colloquium group of majors. And so we brought together a number of majors that were either in the SAMS program out there or a Command General Staff College. And what we had done is they had a half dozen problem sets that they were supposed to take a look at. And then they out brief me or the chief, and we sit there about things that the Army can do to increase rate of innovation. We had everything from talent management to, you know, how do you take a lieutenant and make him or her the chief of staff of the Army? How do we increase diversity? How do we increase the ability to use critical thinking skills to increase rate of innovation? And so really the first thing I think we were educating the majors on is that, okay, it's great if you can answer these problems for us. It took a lot of notes, but see, an organization that is intent on increasing the rate of innovation, the way you do that is you have to increase rate of information flow. And there's an expectation on, as a member of the profession, that you as a major, you need to pass on your good ideas to four-star generals. The trade-off commander, the chief of staff of the Army, has tasked you, major, to think through this problem and then in a coherent manner lay it out to us, of which then we will take notes and I'll go back and see the chief, et cetera. And then the required, other part of that is then we'll come back to them and say, well, we've thought about this, this won't work, this will work there. So that's part of being a professional, is that that's an expectation that you have that dialogue there. With regards to the critical thinking piece of it, what we are doing extensively now is working that into all levels of professional military education. That it is inadequate to say, well, we're going to have the critical thinking elective at the War College. And sort of when they get there, they take a look at it. That literally, from the very beginning and basic training, within what is reasonable, we're sort of working that into the curriculum. So Sergeant Major Davenport and I were down to Fort Jackson a couple days ago, and 2,100 hours at night when all the buses come in and these young high school kids get off the bus with their overnight bag, and there's that Strack-looking soldier with that brown hat on that gives them a nice warm welcome when they come to the front door of the United States Army. We are inculcating them into being a soldier, but from the very beginning, we start kind of contextualizing it from, in that we want them to understand why it is of what they're doing and seeing the bigger picture. So, for instance, a basic rifle marksmanship. Those of us that have been in the Army a while have gone through that. And what we used to do in basic training is you'd have all the soldiers there. They'd fire their M16 or whatever. You know, Joe Sergeant would go down and say, no, you bolo, get back in the redo. Bolo, get back in the redo. You go here. What we do now is say, explain. This is what happens. A steady hold factors. Hey, soldier, come down and take a look at this. Do you see where all your rounds are? Yeah, what's that a problem of? Well, that's a problem. That's a breathing problem, et cetera, like that. Okay, so now you understand why you're boloing, not just that you boloed. So Sergeant Major and I had lunch with a number of basic trainees, and there were some sitting right across the table from myself. And finally, you could get them to talk. And was asking them about what was going on. I said, it's similar. It reminded me of the M&M's commercial you see at Christmas time where the M&M's are sitting there and Santa Claus comes down and they're like, hey, he really exists. You know, it was only a myth. Well, when Sergeant Major and I are there, they're just staring at us like generals and Sergeant Majors really exist. You know, we only heard about them in mythology. And so I was asking, this soldier had been in the Army 3 weeks. So he was not new. He was a veteran. He'd been in the Army 3 weeks. And basic training. I said, so what do you like best about basic training? Well, sir, I like the basic riflemanship, marksmanship. He said, in fact, we just fired today. I said, how'd you do? He goes, well, it's my worst score. I can't remember what he got, etc. like that. But I went and looked at the target. He said, I think my problem is a trigger problem. I've got to pull it more evenly like that. And so when I breathe, I do this. And I mean, this kid's been in the Army 3 weeks. And he's given me a detailed analysis of why he didn't fire expert because he figures he has a trigger problem, but he's thought through what he's going to do better next time, et cetera, like that. Like, you know, that is critical thinking. So we have to start at the very beginning. It's not the elective at CGC or War College.
Thank you very much, sir. So the next question are for Dr. Russell and Dr. Falls because of your scientific credentials. And the question is this. What are the easiest areas, in your opinion, to make small investments with big returns, example, as in electronics, and where are the areas, in your honest opinion, where you think the worst rates of return are most likely?
You want to try?
I'll take the first part. You can trash the investment. Someone said Mary Miller's here. I don't know where she's I was just thinking, because it was primed by the question about education, that the training opportunities are really phenomenal, live virtual constructive training opportunities. They don't cost a lot of money, and LVC is great, but the adaptive tutoring going all the way back to a session, bringing recruits up to an even level and then rapidly training them up in all manner of technical and non-technical areas. That's a phenomenal opportunity, and I think that we're not paying enough attention to it for all the right reasons. I know we have a lot of O&M responsibilities and things going on, but that would be my top of the list, actually.
You're not going to do the bottom half?
No, that's you.
actually, I'm not sure there... It's very hard to define what would be a poor return on investment. I mean, I can define a poor return on investment, but so, I think it comes down to, instead of picking a technology, it comes down to the idea that we would define an area of research or technology we wish to actually invest in. But as I mentioned before, the progression that we're making is not actually meeting the advancements of the challenges we're trying to address. And because of that, what happens is that you never really get a true return on investment. And so you can never overcome. So if we have an overmatch situation, let's say today, and we're investing in something that is not going to develop at a pace faster than that overmatch is developing, then that would be a poor return on investment. That would mean that we've actually made a decision and selected something where we haven't thought through how much progression, how much progress we can make as an Army versus what our adversaries are making. And I don't think I want to identify any of those at the moment publicly. But I would say that there are areas that we, beyond just the training, that we really need to think about is in where there are opportunities near term. And I do think the AOC and the warfighting challenges help us define some of those from the S&T community, because we now have some input to areas where we could actually provide a significant contribution technically to help actually offset some of those warfighting challenges. And there are areas in sensing in particular, which I think the question asked, where we could think about developing improved sensing capabilities. In particular, night vision would be an area where we actually need to probably could do some things and changes in wavelengths, which could make a huge difference with minimal investments to improve our ability to continue to own the night.
I'll follow up just briefly, and that is, it's very hard to pick winners and losers in technology because you just don't know where things are going to go. But at the end of the day, our investment in basic research is dwarfed, by the major, the big acquisition programs. And as the general said, learning how to say no to those is probably a much better use of our time than trying to, because there's an awful lot of oversight of S&T, believe me. And so, maybe the attention needs to be more on where we're spending other kinds of dollars.
So our final question will be for Bob Coker. And Bob, this question draws on both your experience as a DARPA PM, but also as a businessman who's been running a company that does innovation. So question is this: how can we be truly innovative if part of the soul of innovation is the acceptance of failure, and failure is costly? How can we be truly innovative until we as an institution learn to tolerate and learn the priceless lessons of failure?
Okay. I'd like to also answer a little bit on the previous question, just one issue. The best application of money is studying the problem before something happens. Because when something happens, it's an incident, you run after it and a lot of money spent, and do you really have something? So it's kind of anticipating, spending, studying, figuring out when something happens, this is exactly what we're going to do. And that's a good avenue there. The question on innovation, rephrase the question again, please.
So everybody understands that to innovate, you have to fail. But we're in a very resource-constrained environment, and so there's part of the price of failure is the waste of resources.
Okay.
Or the apparent waste of resources. So how can we accelerate and re-emphasize a culture of innovation at the same time we've got this resource constraint?
Okay. You have to study the problem. At DARPA, we would look, when somebody proposed something, we look at what is the hardest part of this. Let's prove if that works. If you're spending a lot of money trying something, but you haven't really engaged the laws of physics, you're going to wind up spending a lot of money. So I think it's thoroughly looking at, is it going to work? And then I think it's talking to the visionary. If this does work, what is the real benefit there? Again, if you look at Warren Buffett, he made where he is by understanding the environment, understanding where to put the resources, and you're making the right decisions. So I think it's study. If you fail, you need to analyze why you failed. And if you fail because you're up against the law of physics, and I can go through examples where people funded stuff where it was doomed for failure in research, then that's wrong. I don't think, I understand tolerating failure, but in reality, I don't know. I don't think we should understand if the person had the right intentions, the right research, everything was done correctly. Okay, I can understand that. But if somebody just haphazardly jumped into something, I don't think we should tolerate that.
Thank you very much. I'd like to thank the audience, both present and distributed, for their questions, and even more, thank the panel for their answers. Thank you very much.